Hey, Gary. Good evening. And welcome to the Enoch Pratt Free Library. My name is Vivian Fisher, and I am Deputy Chief of the Pratt Library State Library Resource Center here at the Central Branch. This evening, I am pleased to introduce our guest, Kevin Powell, in conversation with Dave Zirin. But before I begin the introductions, I would like to remind you that for upcoming programs, please check out our webpage and our campus newsletter. We will also have about 15 minutes of Q&A after the conversation, and we will have a bookseller outside the auditorium for your book purchases. Now to our guests. Kevin Powell is a writer, activist, public speaker, pop culture aficionado, politician, and television personality. He is the author of 16 books, and he was a senior writer during the founding years of Vibe magazine from 1992 to 1996. His activism has focused on ending poverty, advocating for social justice, and counteracting violence against women and girls through local, national, and international initiatives. He was a curator for the first exhibit on the history of hip-hop in America at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland, Ohio, And in 2014, he was invited by the Welsh government to the United Kingdom for a series of lectures and workshops on the 100th birthday of 20th century poet Dylan Thomas. As a result, he was named the International Ambassador for the Dylan Thomas Centennial in America. Cornell University owns the Kevin Powell Archives, documenting his work to date in print, photos, videos, books, handwritten notes, speeches, and select memorabilia, beginning with his appearance in the first season of the first television reality series, MTV's The Real World, New York, in 1992. And I know some of you all remember that. His writings have appeared in numerous publications, including Esquire, Ebony, The Washington Post, Rolling Stone, and Vibe magazine, to name a few. He is also the president and co-founder of BK Nation, a national progressive multicultural organization founded on such issues as education, civic engagement, leadership training, and much, much more. Dave Zirin is an American political sports writer. He is a sports editor for The Nation, a weekly magazine dedicated to politics and culture, and writes a blog named Edge of Sports, the weekly columns by Dave Zirin. He is also the author of 11 books. Zirin has produced two documentaries, Not Just a Game, Power Politics in American Sports and Race, Power and Politics in American Sports by Media Education Foundation. He received a NAACP Image Award nomination as a co-author of the John Carlos story, The Sports Movement That Changed the World. His writings have appeared in the New York Times, Vibe magazine, the Los Angeles Times, the Washington Post, the Baltimore Sun, and numerous other newspapers and publications. And he also has a radio program called The Collision that's on WPFW. Please join me in welcoming to the Pratt Library in Baltimore, Kevin Powell and David Zirin, to discuss Powell's latest work, The Kevin Powell Reader.
Wow, it's so wonderful to be here. My goodness, it's great to see friends here. That's amazing. It's great to be here with the man of the moment, Mr. Kevin Powell. You want to give him a round of applause, please?
Thank you.
And I'd be remiss if I didn't say very briefly that this is the first time I've been to this library since I was married here.
Oh, wow.
20 years ago. And this library has had an amazing renovation. It's a huge success story. But I'm also very happy to say that the room where we were married, the Edgar Allan Poe room, looks exactly the same. So it was memory overload taking some selfies or some photos, I should say, thanks to Sophia. And thanks to Cleve as well and all the incredible people. Thank you for this amazing introduction. And thank you, Baltimore.
Yes. I'm so happy to be here.
Oh, my goodness, sir.
And we're back there talking sports because me, Cleve, and Dave are big sports fans. Even though I'm a New Yorker, I have a lot of respect for the history of sports in Baltimore. Let me just say that. Lamar Jackson just signed that contract finally.
That is a story, yeah. For sure.
Yeah. Let's see what happens from there, right?
Yeah. You know, Kevin, there's so much I want to ask you about
book. Not sports. We got to focus.
No. It's just the Kevin Powell Reader, as someone, I'll just say, who's been reading you for over 30 years. Like for me, it was very emotional to read you over the course of the decades. But before we talk about that, I'd be really remiss if I didn't ask you to say a few words as an artist and activist yourself about the passing of the great Harry Belafonte at age 96.
Wow. Whew. Well, now, yes. I just, first shout out to our elders out there. And hey, Brother Payne, I want to just, I got a chance to meet Mr. Belafonte a couple of times. I know his daughter, Gina Belafonte. And what I said today on this radio show this morning, when I was in college, and this is why Black history and all history is important, I did not know that Paul Robeson existed or that Harry Belafonte existed until I got to college. And some folks are looking like, how's that possible? Well, it's possible because we unfortunately have a school system you know, that erases the history of us. That's just a reality. And, you know, I got to Rutgers on a financial aid package because of the civil rights movement. Little did I know, it was people like him who made it possible for people like me to be a first generation college student, literally. And so I don't take that for granted. And studying Paul Robeson at Rutgers, because he went to Rutgers, inevitably led me to Harry Belafonte, because I was digging for everything about Paul Robeson. And I remember coming across something that Harry Belafonte said Paul Robeson is who he modeled his life after. Mm-hmm. And so I said, this is one of the people I want to model my life after. I'm an activist, I'm an artist, I'm a writer. And man, you know, and any of us who are old enough remember, obviously, you know, things from the 1980s, like him being an elder who supported hip hop. Hip hop is 50 years old this year, you know, and Mr. Belafonte was one of the few elders who supported hip hop by producing Beat Street, one of the landmark hip hop films. Mm. People forget that. And obviously that same time period, We Are the World, and he was the one who spearheaded that. We see out front Michael Jackson, Quincy Jones, Lionel Richie, but people don't realize the hand that Harry Belafonte had in that. And then when I went back and I started studying, you know, his support of the civil rights movement and how close he was to Sidney Poitier, you know, and I wrote a long poem for Ebony Magazine about Mr. Poitier, which I think is in the reader, actually. Yeah. It is in the reader. You know, and I thought about Mr. Belafonte when Sidney Poitier died, because they had an inside-outside game. For those who are sports fans, think about it like this. Poitier and Harry Belafonte were friends since they were young. One, you go inside Hollywood, you do your thing, you establish yourself. Sidney Poitier, me, Harry Belafonte, I'm going to support the movement that's happening out here. You know what I mean? Even if it means sacrificing parts of my career. And so I think about that a lot with him and how he kept fighting the good fight literally into his 90s. And I think about that now, you all, because we can't expect our elders just to do everything. You know what I mean? And I shout out to anyone out there who's over 65, over 70 or older. But people keep saying, well, what are we going to do? We got to organize. We have to organize, organize, organize. And one of the things I think about Mr. Belafonte, he was constantly trying to organize people, bring people together. How do we change this thing? And y'all know where we're at right now. We got work to do. And, you know, if he could do it into his 90s, if you're just in your 40s or 50s or 30s, we have no excuse. We have no excuse, you know. And so I want to honor Mr. Belafonte. Ashe, to our ancestor.
Well said. Beautifully said. And the only thing I would add is your insistence on making sure we see Harry Belafonte in a historical thread with Paul Robeson, yeah. I think is so important, because I've been watching a lot of media about Harry Belafonte. And of course, the media sands off his radical edges.
Of course they
do. And the other thing they do is they call him the template of the artist and activist. When, as you say, if Harry Belafonte was asked, what was your template? He would say Paul Robeson.
That's right. That's right. You know, and we can't allow anyone to erase our history. It's really that basic. You know, I was self-hating the first 18 years of my life. I was an A student. My mama, single mother, did the best she could with what she had, you know, but I didn't know, unless you have a mother, father, parent, mentor, role model who says to you, you have to know this history. This is important. You know, I mastered Edgar Allan Poe, who I still love to this day. I mastered Shakespeare, but I had no idea that Lorraine Hansberry, Harry Belafonte, Sonia Sanchez, Mary Baraka, I mean, all these folks existed. I didn't know what the Black Panther Party was. I didn't know about the civil rights movement. In fact, when I think about it now, when we did history or social studies, Dave, they always stopped after World War II. And I'm the generation that was born right after the civil rights generation. So, like, that's not a coincidence. We want you disconnected. You don't even need to know that movement even happened. Are y'all with me out there? You know, and so I grew up hating myself as an African person, as a Black person. And it was because I discovered people like Paul Robeson, which led me to Mr. Belafonte, that I began to find my purpose as a young person. Reading is critical, y'all. Reading is critical. And I need to say this. I want to thank God for this opportunity, my ancestors, you, Brother Dave, Brother Cleve, this library, Sister Sophia, my wife who's here, who I love dearly. And I want to thank y'all for being here, because I know you could be somewhere else. I just appreciate y'all.
So you're experiencing something now that I think few of us can relate to. You are looking at a compendium of your writings over the course of more than four decades.
Can I borrow someone's book? Is that possible? I promise to give it back. I know you paid for it. Thank you so much. This is crazy, y'all.
The big ask is what's that like, and what feelings does it evoke, and what stories for you really do stand out that you've either written, or like poetry that you've written, like when you read it over, what stabs you a little bit?
I mean, you know, the first essay in the book is I was 17. And I had to dig for it. I had to dig for where it was published at. This is why teachers matter. Anyone who's an educator out there, I love y'all. There's a a black woman named Mrs. Lillian Williams. She's passed, she's gone, but she's my 12th grade English teacher. And she saw something in me, and I was a very introverted person. I had very low self-esteem, even though I had good grades, but I didn't believe in myself. I love sports. That's why me and Dave share a love of sports. I played baseball and ran track, but I love reading because my mom took me to the library when I was 8 years old, and I fell in love with books. The first books I read were sports books. I keep coming back to that. There's a reason for that. If you ever meet young people who say they don't like to read, point them toward, ask them what do they like to do. And for me, it was sports. You feel what I'm saying? And then I got to the other stuff. But Mrs. Williams encouraged me to enter an essay contest. And that essay I actually founded, and I found the educator who awarded me the savings bond, $100. And because I was poor, I was like, I don't want a savings bond, I want cash. And she said, no, we're gonna give you a savings bond. I didn't know what a savings bond was. But I decided to put that essay in here because that was the beginning of it all for me. And if you'd have told me when I was 17, oh my God, countless articles, essays, blogs, publications, cover stories. I mean, you know, I wouldn't have, it's humbling because my mother has an eighth grade education. My grandmother, her mother could not read or write. And I just found out a couple years ago, y'all, that my father, who's been dead for 20 years, and I didn't even know he was dead for 10 years because they weren't together and I never really knew him. I found out my father was completely illiterate. And so for me to have a reader is just a profound thing. And I don't take that for granted. This is for the people of Baltimore. This is for East Baltimore. This is for Brooklyn. This is for Harlem. This is for Anacostia, D.C., South L.A. This is for people of East Oakland, the Ninth Ward of New Orleans, all the folks who come from the bottom like me. You know what I mean? But we don't allow the bottom to define us. And honestly, the connecting thread through all of this stuff is that my mother taught me the love of storytelling because she's from the South, and Black folks from the South are kind of amazing storytellers. You know what I'm saying, Ms. Harlan? Yes, ma'am.
You know, I also see as a common thread in all of your writings, an assertion of your own life, which I think we take for granted now with a lot of the reading we do. But I feel like your insistence on not holding back from the reader, that your analysis is informed by poverty or by racism or even by much more difficult things like difficult relationships with women or
my
your
mom.
Mother,
yeah.
Certainly. It's like you let the reader in to know who you are as a way of understanding your subject. And that was bracing when you were doing it. And it's still bracing. And I was wondering if that was something that you think about consciously when you approach a story, or if that's not something you see in your work.
Well, I mean, as a writer, as an artist, writing is as important to me as breathing. I've been saying that for a long time. And writing is therapy to me. I didn't set out to write like that. When I got to college, there was racism that happened when me and another Black male student got stopped by the campus police our first semester and asked for our IDs as we were surrounded by white students. And so we wrote a piece together that was response to it. But it was my college experience at Rutgers, learning about Paul Robeson. I had a class in the Harlem Renaissance, which introduced me to Zora Neale Hurston and Langston Hughes. At some point, I discovered James Baldwin. You know, my music taste started to shift. I was told I should listen to Marvin Gaye's What's Going On. I need to listen to Bob Marley. You know, I need to listen to The Last Poets. You know, I need to listen to Still Pulse. And so I started to say, why can't I put some of this in my writing? You know what I mean? How I feel. Because I was angry. And there's nothing wrong. People act like you should not be angry. What I've learned as I've gotten older, this proactive anger where you put it into your work, you build something, an institution, an organization, a business that serves the community. And then it's a reactionary anger where you destroy. But I just felt like for me, writing is a way to try to make sense of the chaos of the world, the madness of this world. Because I'm like, why are we poor? Why am I and my mother poor? Why are Black folks forced to live in certain environments? You know what I mean? Like why, when my wife and I have traveled this country, I've been to all 50 states, y'all. I didn't even get on a plane until I was 24. But once I started traveling, why does every city have 1,000 churches and 1,000 liquor stores and rental centers and check cashing places? Y'all with me out there? And fried chicken places. And a lot of funeral homes, and there's a lot of bombed out buildings. Y'all know what I'm talking about, Baltimore. And like, why? I used to think that it was just where I was from. And so what writing helped me to do was, one, I'm not crazy for feeling what I'm feeling. Like, no one should be poor. I believe that poverty is a form of violence. You know what I mean? Because, and I'm gonna ask y'all, please don't film this. We got someone filming this. Please don't film this, y'all. They're filming it for the library, so let's let them do it exclusively, if you don't mind. I appreciate that. Plus, I want y'all to listen, because what I've been saying is I've been going to Stop to Stop. Everyone pulls out their phones. My wife and I went to a wedding a couple months ago, my cousin's wedding. The moment that my cousin and her husband came in the aisle, everybody, even grandmama who's 99 years old, pulled their phone out. And I'm saying to y'all, let's not be addicted to these things. I miss this because of COVID. I miss being with people. So I prefer we just listen. Remember we used to do that back in the day? Isn't that a wonderful concept, just to be connected to each other? So I think what does writing do? Can help me to connect to myself and connect to other people and realize that you're not in this by yourself.
Yeah, clearly from what you're saying, libraries played an incredible role in your development. A lot of the authors that you've mentioned as influences, they're seeing their books banned from libraries. So the Kevin Powells of the future are not even going to be able to be influenced and developed the way you were by these incredible writers and artists. What do you have to say to a country that looks like it's stepping backwards from any sort of enlightenment with regards to some of the certainly Black artists and historians they're trying to silence?
I fully expect this book to get banned somewhere once someone gets wind of what's actually in it. Because I'm calling out this country and its insanity, you know what I mean? It's racism, it's systemic racism. And when he's, you know, it's, but the problem with this country, you know, and I think if people really, you know, people play around with this word patriot because, you know, these right wingers try to redefine words. But if you really are a patriot, then, you know, you should be criticizing the country because you want it to be better. Am I right, y'all? You know, and it's something wrong with any country where you're not even allowed to express how you feel. And let's tell the truth. This country was founded on the genocide of indigenous people, the genocide and enslavement of African people. We built this country up free labor for 250 years, you know, and I think about that. And so the country was actually founded, quote unquote, on a series of lies. You know what I mean? And, you know, if it wasn't for people like my ancestors and some of y'all in this room, no matter what your backgrounds are, who said we have to fight for justice and equality for all people. I mean, imagine what this country would look like if there had not been an abolitionist movement. Imagine what this country would look like if it hadn't been the Garvey movement in the 1920s, the civil rights movement. Imagine, you know, where we would be. And so it's not like these changes happened just because of someone's kindness. People had to sacrifice literally their lives for this, you know? And so when I think about the banning of books, this is just par for the course. We literally, you know, people have been so obsessed with Donald Trump. It's not Trump, y'all. This has been going on. I went to college during the Reagan-Bush years. This was happening during the Reagan-Bush years. You know, myself and other students that I went to college with, we were literally going from the North to the South to re-register voters as teenagers because they were knocking people off the rolls. The same thing is happening now. Yeah. The same issues around women's right to choose, women's control of their own bodies, that was happening back then. And so what I'm saying to you all, what's clear to me with this banning of books, this is just a continuing of a narrative that's been happening. I mean, think about it, y'all. Is it a coincidence that in 1968, Dr. King, our alpha brother, was killed in April of 68. 2 months later, June 68, Bobby Kennedy is killed. And then 68, later in that year, Richard Nixon becomes president of the United States under a platform of law and order. That was 1968. And these folks are saying the same thing, because literally what we see anytime there's been progress and even incremental progress, because think about this for a second, Brother Dave and everyone out there. Black folks were asking for some very basic things. Can we vote? And can I be treated as a human being? Can I just walk down the street of a guy getting murdered for who I am? Can we vote? You know what I mean? We wasn't asking for a whole bunch of stuff. Now, I would gladly take my 40 acres and a mule. I'm still waiting for that. I would gladly take my reparations check. I'm still waiting for that. But voting, and can we be treated as human beings? Why is that problematic to anyone? And so when you talk about the banning of books now, what we know is that anytime there's been a, God bless you, salut, any kind of minuscule progress, think about the end of slavery, there was Reconstruction, 1865 to 1877, and then bam, we're shutting this down. You know what I mean? After the Civil Rights Movement, bam, we're shutting this down. After Obama, bam, we're shutting this down. And so, but the point I'm getting to y'all is that, and I'll leave it here because I know we got a lot of questions, Dave. The heart of the Civil Rights Movement was 1955 to 1968, 13 years from Emmett Till. And we just saw today, the racist white woman who got him killed died today without ever facing any justice, right? Emmett Till, 1955, Montgomery Bus Boycott, 1955, 68, Dr. King is killed. That's 13 years. What I'm saying to y'all, and the elders out there know what I'm talking about. Any elders out there who participated in the Civil Rights Movement, just hold your hand up. You have some memory, recollection of it. Hold your hand up for a second. God bless y'all. God bless y'all. They will tell you that was a long period of time. right? And I was excited in the summer of 2020 when we saw masses of people of all different colors, all different identities on the streets around the country. Y'all know what I'm talking about, right? Remember that? But it was for a couple of months. 13 years versus a couple of months. Meanwhile, Nixon got elected in 68, and we're still dealing with this right-wing movement in 2023. They literally stole the techniques of the civil rights movement and applied it to this right-wing, fascist, racist, sexist, transphobic, homophobic, anti-human being platform. They're organized. Over here, the rest of us, we're fighting each other, if we're fighting at all. You know, what we call the Olympics oppression. And what I believe, in the spirit of Kimberly Crenshaw, our sister, and other folks, we got to see the intersectionality of it all so we can come together. Does that make sense? So we actually need a progressive, multicultural, multigenerational movement of people to counter this white nationalist, white supremacist movement. That's why it's winning, because they're organized and they're clear. We don't like immigrants. We don't like women. We don't like queer folks. We don't like people of color. We don't like Black folks. We don't like Black history. Should I go on, y'all? They're clear. We over here, man, just woken up, focus on our stuff. I mean, listen, I'm a vegan. I'm a Black man. I'm a heterosexual Black man. Of course, I am clear that as a Black man, there's certain issues that are specific to what I got to deal with as a Black man. But how dare I act as if my oppression doesn't mean that I have to, I can't talk about the oppression of women or queer folks or poor folks or disabled folks. Y'all with me out there? Or immigrants, y'all with me out there? How do we connect it together? And so the banning of books is just a symptom, Brother Dave, of the bigger problem, which is they're organized and we over here with single issues.
Wow.
Yes, divide and conquer.
I'm gonna take us back now about 31 years.
Oh Lord.
And
when I had hair. Hey, Brother Mills. Hey, Brother Payne. And good to see y'all.
Who in the room remembers something called Vibe Magazine? Oh my goodness. Vibe Magazine, 1992, puts out its first issue.
Yes, sir.
Quincy Jones behind it. Everybody looking at this as the magazine of the moment, particularly coming out of the LA uprising earlier that year. It was the, you know, that's everybody was repeating the Chuck D line about, you know, CNN. Of the Black community, yeah. Is, you know, is rap music. And yeah. So here's this magazine that comes out of the moment. And who do they ask to write the first cover story in Vibe Magazine? It was Kevin Powell.
Wow.
And the one word question, how?
One answer, God. I mean, you know, Black folks ain't got the luxury not to believe in something, given what we've had to deal with. And I worked hard, man. I worked hard. My mama raised me to work hard. My mother, you know, started working when she was 8 years old picking cotton in South Carolina. And when I was 8 years old, we were at a grocery store. She said, "Boy, bag those groceries, start working." And that's what I had to do. Hey, Brother Tiff, I see you. Peace to you. And so work. And but, you know, I was in a hurry, man. I got my first check as a writer when I was 20 years old. I was still in college. I would literally get on a bus and commute up to New York. Like, you hear the famous stories about Diddy, Puffy, Puff Daddy, for those of us who are older, getting on a train and going from D.C., from Howard to New York. I was doing the same thing as a young writer. And I just, you know, I knew that's what I wanted to do. And I just read everything. I took literally, this is important for me to say, I took literally one creative writing class in college and one journalism class. And I thought they were both garbage. The creative writing class, I mean, and why? Because I was the only Black student in the class. And, you know, they tell you, the writing teachers, write from your experiences. Well, man, I'm like, I'm writing about rats and roaches. You know what I'm saying? That's where I come from. You know, I might be professional middle class now, but I come from rats and roaches and no heat, no hot water. You know what I'm saying? That's where I come from. Paint chips falling out the ceiling. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You know, liquor stores everywhere, like I said. And so I remember that I forgive me for a second. I normally do not curse in public. I want to say that to y'all. But in the story that I wrote for this creative writing class in college, I wrote that they shit it. My teacher would, but I also had a lot of stuff about mayhem and violence in my short story. The teacher, a white woman, was so taken aback by what I was writing about. She was like, the only criticism she gave me It's not shitted. You should say shat.
Painful.
And I said, man, my mom and them don't be saying no shat. And luckily, by that point, I was reading Zora Neale Hurston and Langston Hughes and Paul Lummers Dunbar, y'all. And they gave me the permission that the language that people like me and my mama speak is actually beautiful poetry. Mm. Y'all feel me? And then in the journalism class, I remember them saying, you know, if it doesn't, you know, anyone who's a journalist knows what I'm saying, if it don't bleed, it don't lead. I'm like, that's got to be my angle. I just got to talk about bloodshed. That's it. And I was like, that's not the kind of journalist I want to be. So I knew that I wanted to tell the stories of my community. I didn't set out to write about hip hop. That wasn't it. But I grew up, I was a B-boy. I was a graffiti writer. You know what I mean? My nickname is Keep 01. That was my tag when I used to tag graffiti. That's when I was a kid. And my best friend in high school was a DJ. So I was a part of the culture. And so by the time Vibe magazine came around, I was already writing a little bit about hip hop. And what I saw it as is an opportunity to merge what I felt as a black man in America with this culture that was our culture, hip hop, right? My mama's culture is Motown, it's Stax Records, hip hop was our thing. And then on top of that, I'm an activist because I had already been in college, and 2 to 4 years I was in college, we took over buildings because we wasn't playing, y'all. You know, so I was like, how do I merge all of this? Because I'm also reading people who are writing about this culture called hip hop, who don't have the sensibilities and the allyship of a brother Dave Z right here, and the love for the people, right? Like brother Dave Z, who are saying all kinds of crazy stuff about hip hop. And that's how it happened. And they didn't tell me that what I was writing about would be the first cover story for Vibe, but it ended up being that way. And it was a blessing, man. It changed my life. You know what I mean? It literally changed my life. And I just, that was the beginning of this, honestly. Mm. It was the beginning of this.
No, and this is a tremendous accomplishment. What advice do you have for young writers?
Wow. Be true to yourself. Be true to your voice. I just had the honor of being the Toni Morrison Writer in Residence at Prairie View A&M University this past year. And I had a lot of Prairie View, HBCU. And the thing that, what I said to my students is my wife knows what I'm talking about, because she went with me a couple of the times there. It was a couple of older professors. Let me say this to y'all. I'm in my 50s now, right? Don't become old, corny because you got older. Seriously, don't become corny and in a box. Some of us act like we don't know what it's like to be a young person. Like you were never 15 or 20 or 25. You know what I mean? And so what do I say to a young writer? Use your voice. Be fearless. You know what I mean? Be fearless, be fearless, be fearless as a writer, as an artist. You know, but also say whatever your art form is, be it writing, dance, playwriting, theater, study everyone who's come before you that you can. And I don't care if you're a Jewish writer, an African-American writer, a West Indian writer, Italian-American, Irish, woman, queer, disabled, also make it a point to find people who are your identity, so you know that what you're doing is possible. Does that make sense? Mm. You know what I mean? I think that's important. So for me, discovering black writers, when I was in college, I discovered the E-185 section of the library. That's where all the black books are. And I was working in the library as work study, but man, they would call on the intercom looking for me. I was in the books, reading the books. I was on the floor reading a Mary Baraka, reading Sonia Sanchez. I was like, man, these books are good. You know what I'm saying? But you got to read. Writers have to read. You know, writers have to read. You know, and I say this to anybody, if you're a music producer, whatever it is, you know, you got to know what came before you. It's just like, I take the craft of writing seriously, like grammar, spelling, you know, you know, people always ask me, do you write every day? Nope, but I think in words. I think in words. Like my friend Radcliffe Bailey, the great visual artist, look him up, y'all, Radcliffe Bailey. Years ago, I asked Radcliffe, do you paint every day? He said, no, but I see the world in colors. Mm. You know, and Radcliffe was in special education when he was a kid. Luckily, his mother was a teacher, and she put him in the art classes. People like Spike Lee, Samuel Jackson, Elton John are big collectors of Radcliffe's work, because she refused to see her son as quote unquote slow. And so writers, even if no one believes in you, you gotta believe in yourself. I'm gonna keep it real with y'all. My mama and my family, they work with their hands. They're laborers. And so when I told my mother when I was 20 years old, mama writer, she was like, what the? You need to get a real job.
Yeah.
Because I was raised by my mother to be a doctor or a lawyer because they make money. And if you look at my high school yearbook, it says that I wanted to be an accountant because I was good at math. But if you really are serious about being a writer as a young person or an older person, you got to go for it.
Yeah. And to be clear, I meant young writers as in new to the craft, not in age. I want to be very, very clear about that.
Yeah.
Never too late to become a writer.
No.
It's a beautiful human activity. Look, a book you've been working, I have to ask you about this because we're in Baltimore.
Yeah.
Because the book you've been working on for many years, which, oh my goodness, I have no words to say my expectation level for when it comes, but it's a biography of Tupac Shakur. And many years been at work at this, and you certainly did your share of interviewing of Tupac. I was hoping maybe you could speak about not just that journey, but the intersection of Tupac and the city of Baltimore.
Well, I mean, first of all, I must say it, and I'm not just saying this because I'm here. I have a deep love for Baltimore, y'all. Billie Holiday, Tupac, you know, it's a lot here. I didn't know until I started doing the research on the Tupac book, because the book also has a mini history of Baltimore, that John Coltrane did his first last concert here in Baltimore in 67. I was like, wow, Baltimore is historic, man.
Wow.
You know what I'm saying? And now, any of y'all who are older, I was a house music head, so we always talk about the music that came out of Baltimore. You know what I'm saying? Baltimore is lit, y'all. But so when I after the first cover story on a Tretch of Annoyed by Nature for Vibe, we had to do a delay. They were like, yo, we're gonna take some time to start this magazine, but y'all need to think about who y'all want to write about. And again, I'm asking folks, please don't film or record this. The library is doing it. Let's respect what they're doing, so it can be housed here as an archival piece. Can we agree to that? That's all I'm asking. Again, I see the phones in the back, on that side and this side. And so I had seen Juice. Of course, I knew Digital Underground, the group that gave Tupac his first shot. But when I saw Juice, it just blew me away. Mm-hmm. You know, and I remember going to the theater, and I was, you know, it was me and a Puerto Rican brother named Tony Medina, a great poet from New York City, who teaches at Howard. He's a PhD now, Dr. Tony Medina. And we were up in Harlem. We went to the theater. And the theater was empty, but they had mad police and mad police dogs, just because this is, anyone who remembers the early 90s, you had New Jack City, you had Boys in the Hood, you had Juice, you had Men in Society, and they seemed to think that black folks were just going to riot at the movie theater. Imagine that. You know, and that never happened. No. They even had police for Do the Right Thing, Spike's film. Oh, it's going to cause riots all over the country. No, what causes riots around the country, rebellions, is when you kill black folks.
Exactly.
For 9 minutes on video and act like it's no big deal. You know what I'm saying? So I came back to Vibe in 1993. And they, you know, we all submitted who we wanted to write about. I had a big, thick folder because I was like, you know, again, I was a student activist. I've been a student leader, a youth leader. And so I knew about, by this point, the Panthers. I knew who Fannie Shakur was. I was like, well, here's who I want to write about. This is Tupac Shakur. You know, I know, you know, he's in this movie, da-da-da. He's got this album out. And, you know, this is who his mama was. And they was like, that's cool, but can you write about Snoop Dogg? I was like, oh. You know what I'm saying? Because remember, 92, 93, The Chronic.
Yes.
Dr. Dre, that was the biggest album in America. Mm-hmm. And I was deflated. I mean, I love Snoop. Mm-hmm. You know what I mean? I love Snoop. And I love what the West Coast, my wife's from the West Coast. I love West Coast hip hop, period. So I said, okay, I'll do that. And I remember going to Jack the Rapper Music Conference in August of 93 to work on the Snoop Dogg piece. But I was with a sister friend of mine who worked at Vibe at the time, in Carla Radford. And we're in a hotel lobby, and there's this crowd around somebody. And it turned out the crowd was around Tupac Shakur. And I'm over here with Carla, and Carla's like, yo, Kev, there's Tupac right there. You should go tell him that you wanted to write an article about him. I said, nah, man, because people were sweating him. You know what I mean? And Carla is bold, and she went through the crowd and tapped Pac on the shoulder, said, yo, Pac, you need to know Kevin Powell. He's going to be writing about you. Pac spins around. Turns out he was as big a fan of me as I was of him. Why? Because he had watched every episode of my season of The Real World on MTV. And that's how it began. Little did I know, 1993, I would literally follow Pac. That was Atlanta. I was in LA with him, New York with him. I interviewed him in prison, the famous prison interview with him. And I was in Vegas when he died. And I didn't go back to Vegas for about 19 years after that day that he died.
Wow.
And so I did three cover stories on Pac for Vibe. The covers were him in a straitjacket. And I had a big argument with my editor at the time. I'm not going to say the person's name, but they insisted on big words that said, is Tupac crazy? You know what I mean? And we had a big argument about that because this person was not really from my community. I said, do you realize how you're stigmatizing black males by saying that we're crazy? You know what I mean? And this was a black person who did this, by the way. And then the second cover story was the prison interview. And, you know, I haven't watched it yet. So if y'all ask, I don't know what Dear Mama, the documentary is like, but what I will tell you, when I did the prison interview with Tupac at Rikers Island, I came back to Vibe office. They said, we have a single that we want you to listen to. They gave it to us privately. It was actually Dear Mama. So I was one of the first people to hear Dear Mama. And because I was raised by a strong Black woman, single mother as well, that song, I broke down there. And then the third cover story, which is the one that is copied the most on Instagram, like people got all these memes around Live from Death Row, is Tupac, Dre, Snoop, and Suge on the cover. Y'all know the cover I'm talking about. And people don't realize we got that from the movie. What's the movie with Robert De Niro and Joe Pesci?
Goodfellas.
We got that from Goodfellas.
Yep.
But the Vibe cover became so famous, people think the Vibe cover happened first. Nah. Nah, Suge had a model, right? But that's how it happened. And then the last cover story, I wasn't at Vibe at the time, was for Rolling Stone. So I ended up doing four cover stories on Pac. And that was in Vegas. And I was, and I'll talk about it in the Tupac, but I'm not going to give away the Tupac book. But I've said this before. I was literally in my hotel room because I kept, you know, I went around the hotel. I went around Vegas. I was trying to get some information like about Pac getting shot for the second time. I'm in my hotel room watching Denzel Washington playing Malcolm X. And literally when Malcolm X, played by Denzel, is on his way to the Audubon Ballroom, you know how Spike has Denzel on the tracking thing that Spike does? I got the call, Kev, you got to get to the hospital. Pac just died. As Malcolm X, played by Denzel, is about to go to Audubon Ballroom and get killed. Yeah. And so I've been to Baltimore. I've been to the performing arts school. I've had the pleasure of sitting with folks. I've been to the East Side. I've been to places here. And I know how important this was to his life, y'all. And I need to say this to y'all. I'm trying not to get emotional.
It's all right.
But it did something to him to have to leave Baltimore and leave that high school. And crack, I don't think we'll ever understand fully in our lifetimes what crack did to generations of people in our communities, including his mother. You know what I mean? And so in the book, and I don't want you got to read the book, but I literally try to recreate the moment that he's told you have to leave Baltimore and go to California, and what that was like, and how he got there, and what he had on his person, because I want people to feel what that was like. And think about it, he only had 8 more years after that. He was only 25, y'all. You know what I mean? And so, you know, it's I didn't plan on, and this is it. I told Brother Dave this today. I'm gonna get this book out because I feel like I owe this to Pac, because when I first met Pac, he said, I want you to be Alex Haley to my Malcolm X. I remember thinking to myself, well, son, I want to be Malcolm X. You know what I'm saying? Too. I'm like, why you gotta be Malcolm? Why can't we both be Malcolm X? Why don't we split it in half? But the point I realized Pac was saying at the time, I don't know how long I got, and I trust you. And so, but it's been a burden. The reason why it's taken so long is because I've had my own life journey, my own life changes. I had a whole bunch of other writings to do clearly with this 400-page book. And there were times I had to step away from it because the story is so heavy. You know what I mean? If y'all are watching the document, people are reporting back to me like, Kev, I'm watching Dear Mama right now. Are you watching it? Are you going to be in it? Da-da-da. I'm like, man, you don't understand. Like, we throw the word trauma around a lot. I'm going to say it again to y'all. I was in Vegas when Pac died. 6 months later, the Notorious B.I.G. was killed. I've lived in Brooklyn my entire adult life. I knew Biggie and Pac. Does that make sense, y'all? Which means after that, I went through a deep depression. And one reason why I haven't drank liquor in 20 plus years is because I went through a period when I was going through that depression after Tupac and Biggie died of drinking, anything to numb the pain of what I felt. Does that make sense? Because when Tupac and Biggie died, I finally understood what it felt like for my mother when Marvin Gaye got killed.
Wow. Wow, come on. Yeah, coming here from the DC area, we reserve that for only the most traumatic and difficult departures.
Yeah, man.
And you know, what's not a departure, honestly, is this book from who you are as a human
Thank
being,
you.
Which is what makes it work. Everybody, please give it up for Kevin Powell.
Thank you. Hey, finally, the person. Thank you. I'm so happy the sign language person is here. This is beautiful. You know, this is important to me. I'm happy for the children. Forgive my language. I didn't mean to curse in front of children and elders, but I just had to say that because I definitely will never say shat. Could you imagine?
Absolutely not. But all questions are wow. fair game. If anybody has them, we have microphones here and here so we can get this for recording purposes.
Is that the good doctor? Hey, doctor. Thank you.
Oh, brother,
you got a Marvin Gaye shirt. Oh, my God.
Man.
Oh, my God.
You know, I welcome you to Chicago, so I'm going to welcome you to Baltimore. You know, I have love for you.
I love you too, brother.
Just to give you a quick history, because you're here and you brought up a great point. There are two famous poets who have Baltimore roots, Edgar Allan Poe.
That's right.
And Tupac. Mm. And folks don't realize that those in the vault in this library is the first poem that Tupac
Cleve
wrote.
Told me that. That's
here.
Right.
And I was with his teacher who actually had the contest. We did a conversation 2 years ago in honor of his transition. And I brought her. She hadn't spoke since then.
Wow.
It was her who actually went to pick him up because he didn't have any money to come down here to receive his reward
wow.
for his poetry.
Yeah.
So you are in definitely holy ground. We talk a lot, but I want to talk about the creative process. Mm. You know, I love Paul Robeson. Brother Dave and I created a,
yes, right.
a school in honor of Paul Robeson. He was one of your
Say
alpha
your name
brothers.
For those who don't know you, brother.
Yeah,
Dr.
Lamar Darnell Shields. So I just want you to share with us your creative process. A lot of times we get a chance to be around creators. Walk us through what that creative process is like for you. And then what do you do when you do get stuck? Because we do get stuck. What is that process like as well?
And before you start, let me just say, great question. We've got a number of people at the microphones. I'd love to get through everybody, so I apologize in asking for a tad brevity, but I do want to get, I just want everybody
like
to get a chance to talk to
a
you.
Tad brevity. I always love that Shakespeare quote, brevity is the soul of wit. I don't use the term writer's block anymore. I haven't in years. I don't believe in saying stuck actually anymore. I just pivot to something else. What I decided to do, because I used to be that tortured writer, like, oh my God, I can't get it out. I listen to music. I watch a documentary film. My wife and I both love theater. She's an artist as well. She's a writer, an excellent writer, excellent photographer. I need to shout my wife out. And I just was leaving, putting myself in the middle of art, creativity. And so to come back to me, you take a walk or go work out something. I just don't believe in writer's blocks saying that or saying that I'm stuck. I just feel like, you know what? I just need to pivot for a moment and they'll come back to it. Of course, I understand deadlines. You know, creative process, it's all over the place. I'd be lying. Like my poetry book, which came out before this, some of the poems just kind of came out. Like, you know, when Sidney Poitier died or Cicely Tyson died, I had to write pieces really quickly because I was like, these pieces are also going to be placed in publications. My wife will tell you, Sidney Poitier poem, which is long, I think it's in here. I'll read part of that if I can, Brother Dave, we have time. We were writing in the back of an Uber half the time. I was just writing. Like, since I was young, I'm like, I'll write on my hand, I'll write on a napkin, I'll write on, you okay?
Yeah, I'm okay.
I'll write on anything. And with cell phones, the notes section, you know what I'm saying? So sometimes it just comes out like that. Something like the Tupac book, which I've been working for a long time. I have a massive Dropbox. I have a lot of research. You know, I literally have traveled to all the places that Pac has been. You know what I mean? Because I'm like, let me get into this. You see what I'm saying? In a certain kind of way. And so it just really depends. I mean, once I get into May, I will be working on the Pac book as much as possible, which means hopefully every day, at least an hour a day. I write best in the morning, like wee hours in the morning when it's quiet. New York City is never really quiet, but amazingly between like 4 a.m. and about 6 a.m., you know what I mean? And so that's my process. I write to music, but it has to be jazz music or classical music. I'm a hip hop head, but I cannot listen to the boom bap when I'm writing. I prefer to be quiet or, you know, and then I turn to a lot of folks that inspire me. And I mean, I think Bob Marley's one of our greatest writers. I think Nina Simone's one of our greatest writers. You know what I'm saying? And so I'll look for folks. Kendrick Lamar is the last piece in his reader. I think he's a brilliant poet and he is a direct lineage of Pac. Since you referenced that piece about Pac. I try to read stuff in the genre that I'm writing in. So if I'm writing a biography like Pac, you know, I'm going to read a lot of biographies and autobiographies. And I also watch a lot of documentaries about people. Does that make sense, y'all? So that's all part of my creative process. Yeah.
We're going to switch sides. So here and then here.
Oh, okay. Thank you. So I'll be real brief,
hey.
Kevin. So I wanted to come tonight to meet you to tell you something. So let's go back to 1992 when you had the conversation with Julie about race.
Yes, ma'am.
And how you felt. It was that conversation that I was able to explain to my two sons what it means to be a young Black male in Baltimore. I was born and raised in Baltimore. I'm 60, wow. And my sons were as well. Mm. But unfortunately, my son, who admired you through hip hop, is not able to meet you because he was killed last year in Baltimore City.
I'm so sorry.
So I just want to give you your accolades for having that conversation with Julie and letting all of us see, even then, that, you know, it's real. And you poured your feelings out, and I just really appreciate that. So that's the one thing I've always wanted to tell you if I ever met you.
Well, what is your name?
My name is Sheila.
Sheila.
Yes.
Can I say something, Cleve? I'm not in a rush. I have, like, time. So if y'all good, I'm good, too. I know I got to sign books. Okay.
Well, the last thing, okay. Well, in that case, the last thing I want to say okay. is I hope that through your peers, through your journey, that you've received accolades for that moment. Because when I saw that moment between you and Julie, that was just really real. It's like you were pouring your heart out, so.
Wait, stay. First of all, thank you. And, my prayers for the spirit of your son. My wife and I and some other folks are working on a documentary film right now about Black male manhood, Black fatherhood. We've been working on it, me for 4 years, her for the last 2 years. And it's been one of the deepest things I've ever had to work on because it's really exploring what has happened to us as Black men in this country, what the system has done to us and how we don't realize we're programmed to hurt each other. You know what I mean? And you know, sometimes sister and Jelani Cobb, Dr. Jelani Cobb, who that's my brother and our alpha brother as well. My shout out to my alpha brothers out there.
I'm your little sister. I'm an alpha angel.
Oh, you're an alpha angel. That's a song. But he has this piece in the New Yorker that y'all should look up. And I just shouted out, I text Jelani about it. It's called Hip Hop at 50, an elegy. And what he said is that many of us, and I think brothers here would agree, many of us were hoping, and I don't think it matters if you're middle class, born middle class, or working class, you're just hoping that you don't die young. Because you hear all this negative stuff about what happens to Black males. And his piece is like, now we're in our 40s and 50s, and you see Black males now dying in their 40s and 50s. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, my heart goes out to you about your son. You know what I mean? But know that this film, my hope with this film, because one thing we didn't talk about, the other thread through my life work, including this reader, I gotta represent Black men. I gotta represent Black boys. You know what I mean? And sisters out there know I am an ally. I ride or die for y'all. You know I do. You know I do. But I gotta represent, this is how I met Dr. Lamar, Dr. Shields, you know, I gotta represent for Black males because it's like, you know, it hurts my heart every time I meet a mother who says I lost my son. You know what I mean? My own mother used to say to me, I don't know if you're gonna make it because of what was happening all around me. You know what I'm saying? I feel like my life is a miracle. Just to be here. And I have a responsibility as long as I don't know how long I'm gonna live, but I'm like, while I'm here, let me do everything I can to try to help some other brothers live. Mm-hmm. And so even when you're talking, the film is dedicated to two young Black males who didn't even make it past 32 years old. One's in his 20s, one's in his 30s. So I need to say that. And to your point about Julie, all I was doing on the first season of Real World, because there was no model. I was asked to be on a show and I thought, well, maybe if I'm on TV, because I went to school with Sister Soldier, y'all, you know, I was like, maybe I'll get a couple of speaking gigs. I had no idea that folks 30 years later would be saying to me, Kev, I heard you when you said, I was 12 years old, I was 10 years old, I was 15 years old, I was 20 years old. You said racism is race plus power. That stuck with me.
Yeah.
Or I never saw a Black person talk like that, especially not the white folks. Mm-hmm. Well. I was who I was. And what y'all don't know, because there was no social media back then, the email, is that I was roundly attacked by a lot of people. I was traumatized. Even the editor-in-chief of Vibe, who gave me the assignment of the first cover story of Vibe, a white brother, a queer white brother, as an ally. Can someone kill their phone for a second? Turn it off for a second. Please, it's cool. He told me that there were white folks who told him not to hire me because of how I talked to white people on that show.
Oh.
Yeah. Jonathan, and God bless Jonathan Van Meter because he ignored them and said, no, I saw your talent. And so, you know, y'all don't know what people like me have gone through. You know, when you speak out, you know what I mean? The opportunities that were lost, how people didn't want to have anything to do with you. couple of years ago, we did a reunion series, reunion episodes for The Real World. I grudgingly did it. But I'll tell you, I know that it was only because of what happened to Breonna Taylor and George Floyd that the thing about it, where in American history have you seen white folks apologize to a black person saying, I was wrong, you were right?
Yeah, that's what Becky,
yeah,
Becky apologized.
And so it's deep, you know. I mean, and pop culture does have its place because it can either help or it can hurt. And we know a lot of it hurts. But, you know, thank you for saying that. Thank you. And God bless you. Yes, ma'am.
Hi, Kevin. Hey. I apologize for that phone.
You're fine.
My name is Sharon Renee Taylor. I'm a former newspaper journalist and a writer.
I know you're in byline.
And first of all, something you said earlier really stuck with me, and you said, be true to yourself.
Yes.
And I so admire you because you realized over 30 years ago who you were. And you've been real with yourself ever since. And that is so admirable because some people are afraid to be who they are.
Yeah.
Some people didn't realize who they were until about 15 years ago. And I'm saying that about myself. Some are still afraid to step in those shoes to do what they're destined to do. So my admiration to you, and thank you so much for being real.
Thank you.
I'm standing at the mic right now because I learned of you on The Real World. I was a fan of so many years. First of all, I wanted to know, how did you come to be on the show? How did you feel going through it? And what's your overall feeling about it now that you have so many 3-4 decades to look back on that experience? And what is your reflection on that?
I'll answer if you promise to read all 450 pages of this book.
Honey, I was one of the first few to buy that book. You're going to sign it.
Thank you. As a young writer, I hustled. I had a part-time teaching job at New York University. I was an assistant for an early diversity office at the New School in New York City. And I was freelancing for everyone I could. Black newspapers like the Amsterdam News, Afro-American newspaper out of Baltimore. Thrasher magazine, a skateboard magazine. I just wrote everywhere I could. I also wrote bios for record labels. So I wrote the first bio for Usher. I did. I wrote a bio for TLC. I interviewed Coach Crisscross. Remember them back in the day? I was hustling, y'all. And there was a group out of Buffalo, New York called Joe Public, who were young brothers who were R&B singers, but they also played instruments. And I wrote their bio for them. Now think about how we were dressing in the early 90s. Our clothes were mad baggy, right? And my hair was like, and I had my ears pierced. My mother was like, you look like you're on drugs. Of course, that's what she said. And we were at a cafe in Midtown Manhattan, New York City called Stardust Cafe. Myself and Joe Public and their publicist, a sister named Chrissy Murray, and a young white sister came up to us and said, I really like you guys. Look, we're doing a show on MTV called The Real World. Would any of y'all be interested? They were a group. They were signed to Columbia Records, right? They couldn't do it. So I took the car because I'm like, I'm in my hustle mode. Like, word, let me check this out. And I made a videotape. One of my college mates made a videotape. And I didn't say anything about my politics. Ha ha. I didn't say anything about my social justice work. Ha ha. I wasn't lying. I was a house music head. I was a hip hop head. So I definitely talked about culture and stuff like that. The only thing I knew about MTV is they didn't want to play Michael Jackson on MTV. And they didn't want to put black people on MTV. So I looked at MTV as like, well, they don't really like black people per se. I know they had Yo TV Raps, but I was like, they don't really like black people for what I saw. But miraculously, they called me and said, we want to interview you. And they asked me questions, like it was really random questions, like, what do you think about sex? I was like, yo, it's dope. What else? What's the other thing? I'm 20 something, y'all. That's what I'm gonna say. And I got picked, and I felt like I had won a game show prize. I didn't know what it was gonna be, but I was a writer. And literally, as I was filming that first season of MTV, two significant things happened. LA exploded in rebellion, and Vibe magazine. I was writing the first article for the first cover story for the first issue of Vibe. So I wasn't thinking about, you know, TV. It wasn't until the show came on and they took us to the Video Music Awards that year. And that year, Michael Jackson, Red Hot Chili Peppers, Howard Stern, all these Nirvana. I saw Nirvana performer, Kurt Cobain. I was like, and I love Kurt Cobain and Nirvana. I was like, and when the seven of us got there, people were cheering for us like we were Michael Jackson or the Beatles. I was like, this is insane. But then it was so short-lived. I went to college with Bill Bellamy, y'all, right? He has a book coming out. You should look for it online. I wrote the foreword for his book. Within a couple months of me being on MTV, Bill Bellamy started hosting on MTV. And it went from people chasing me down the street, like, Kevin. One funny moment, I was in LA, I was standing with LL Cool J, and I clearly do not look like LL Cool J in any way, shape, or form, right? I mean, this is a big, muscular dude, right? And these young ladies worldwide, and they started screaming my name, like LL wasn't even standing there. I was like, this is crazy. This is LL Cool J. I'm little puny Kevin. But within a few months, people on the streets were like, Bill Bellamy. They were calling me. I was like, damn, fame is fleeting, boy.
But
so that's how I felt about it. But also, I remember my mother calling me when I got into the arguments with my white castmates, my mother from South Carolina, born during the Jim Crow era of black folks getting hung from trees and being brutalized. My mother was terrified that I had talked to white people like that on TV. Mm. Terrified.
Wow.
Like something was gonna happen to me.
Wow.
And then I dealt with a lot of repercussions of the racism of people through the years. And it was traumatic because, you know, they don't give you a blueprint. You become sort of a celebrity, but they don't give you a... Think about it, y'all. We've seen this happen to Marvin Gaye, to Amy Winehouse, Kurt Cobain, Whitney Houston. You know, nothing prepares you for that. You're out there. This is why, you know, like all this happened in my 20s. I'm a star writer, so-called, at Vibe Magazine, and I'm on this hit TV show. And by 30, I was a drunk and depressed and unemployed. So that's what happened.
Yeah.
And I had to rebuild myself over and over again. And I'm just thankful that I'm still here.
Before I call on the next person, and no need to respond to this, I just say one of the things I really respect about Kevin is that fame is fleeting, but fame is also a drug. And Kevin has chosen to spend the decades like working on his craft as opposed to going on like celebrity weight loss challenge or whatever, you know, like he could have done that and had that kind of life.
I could have been a Kardashian, damn it. Yeah, we'd have known they were gonna make that kind of money.
Yeah.
I'm sorry.
No, but focusing on the craft,
yeah,
that is an incredible example for people as far as what has weight and what matters in this world.
Tiff.
Hey, what's up, Kevin?
Good to see you, brother. Good to see you.
More had to see you, bro.
Thank you.
First of all, I say, you mentioned Motel and the Stack. You left out TSOP, but that's
my bad. That's right. I'll be in Philly tomorrow, so God forgive me.
All right. I would like to say, I don't believe in the commercialization of art, but I mean, hip hop has went really further than anybody will ever expect us to go.
Yeah.
Now, us being poets, you know me, you, Tony Medea, Sonya, I mean, Jessica, Talam and everything. How do you think we can take our craft of spoken word to the next level, to where we have a commercial with Martha Stewart?
Oh, Snoop and his Coors commercial on the beach? Snoop has reinvented himself a few times. I wrote that cover story. When I wrote the cover story on Snoop, he was on trial for murder, y'all. Now he's chilling with Martha Stewart and doing Coors commercials. It's deep. Be willing to reinvent yourself. And, you know, I mean, it's so much stuff to say. Hip hop was created by poor people, poor African-Americans, poor West Indians, poor Latinx folks in New York City. Poor people created hip hop. The same poor people Dr. King told us not to forget, which is why he was organizing a poor people's campaign at the end of his life. And poor people don't want to be poor. I want to make that very clear to y'all. Like, I didn't want to be poor. And so I think that we need to figure out ways to monetize our art, but not in a way that sells our souls. You know what I mean? Like, yeah, I've been around, and thank you for what you said, sister. I feel blessed to say I've been a published writer for a long time, but I can't tell you how much stuff I've turned down because I'm like, this is selling my soul. You know what I mean? And everyone has a choice to make. My work is for the people. I'm very clear about that. I'm for the people. That's what I was rooted in, you know what I mean, as an activist. And I don't separate the activist from the art. I'm for the people. You know, and you just have to kind of, like what I did, I studied Langston Hughes, Tiff. You know, how did Langston start writing in his early 20s? And he kept writing until he was in his 60s when he died in 1967, and he had a career for himself. He kept reinventing himself, but he also was able to, back to the craft thing Dave was talking about, but Doctor, what you're talking about, I can write poems, I can write screenplays, I can write plays, I can write blogs or essays, I can write articles, I can news report. I made it a point very early on, let me learn as many different ways of writing as possible. You know what I mean? Let me know how to make a documentary film. Let me do all that kind of stuff. And also I made a conscious decision that I just want to live a simple life. Like, you know, my home, my wife and I, who I love dearly, my best friend, you know, we share a love of books. We share a love of art. You know, art on our walls and images. We share a love of basic things, you know. And so I drive, y'all. I've driven across country. I've never owned a car in my life. You know, I don't, she'll tell you, I don't know what a Toyota Avalon is, really. You know what I'm saying? I just decided, like, you know what? I may never have a lot of money, but what I can be rich at is what I actually do. You know what I'm saying? And then, you know, I think poets especially, because Amir Barak said it, you know what I'm talking about, Tiff, that poets are the NIGGAs of the art world, of entertainment. But I think that we don't have to be if we decide, let me start making sure that my work is tied to music. You know what I'm saying? Because poetry is music. There's a musicality in how we write poetry. I think, you know, the genius of Entezaki Shange, when you think about For Colored Girls, which is one of the most incredible plays ever written, it's actually 20 poems that were put together. Mm-hmm. You feel what I'm saying? That's the genius of For Colored Girls. You know what I'm saying? August Wilson's plays are poetry because August Wilson was a poet first. Does that make sense? You know what I mean? Smokey Robinson is a poet.
Best of all time.
Of all time. Bob Dylan said that Smokey Robinson was America's greatest poet. I got sunshine.
On a cloud.
What's the rest of it?
Cold outside.
I got the month of May.
That's called poetry, y'all. That's Smokey Robinson who wrote My Girl. And we all know the lyrics across generations, races, identities, doesn't matter, right? That's what we got to do. Make our poetry relevant to the people in ways where they meet them, where they are.
Absolutely.
One last thing before I go. It was an honor when you came down. I love your work. And my first
I love
message,
your work too,
you
sir.
Requested a poem for me and my guy to do. It was A Change Gonna Come. He was singing. I was.
That's right. Oh, my God.
But sad to say, that brother, he's locked up for life for bank robbery.
I'm sorry.
So it just. Cherry is going, you know.
I mean, you know, and Tiff, I know we got to keep moving, but it's just like, man, I sometimes like, why not me? I mean, like, I've suffered from survivor's guilt because I've seen people around me fall. And believe me, you know, you asked the question, sister, how have you done it? I have fallen many times. I'm not going to sit here and lie to y'all and say I've had some miraculously perfect life. It's been a lot of tension, a lot of trauma. Thank God for therapy. Thank God for spiritual practice. Thank God for being honest. Thank God for sometimes hitting rock bottom and having to get humbled in deep ways to get back up, you know what I'm saying? And realizing the importance of life. And, you know, I'm just grateful for every day. And it hurts my heart because I do a lot of work in the prison system. When I see brothers and sisters in there, because we know these prisons are built for brothers and sisters, y'all. That's what the prison industrial complex is. And it's locked up so many of us, you know what I mean? But it's just like, you know, I think those of us who are out here, we just got to keep pushing and trying to make sure we save lives. Save lives. We have a powerful moment in our black male documentary that's coming. We'll bring it back to Baltimore. I guarantee we'll bring it to Baltimore and do a screening like this or in a room like this, where a brother said he was in jail for 30 years and he decided when he came out, my job now is to be a fire person in the community so I can help put out the fires that are happening with people who want to do what I did, which is how I got in jail for 30 years. Whew. So
amazing.
Yeah. Hey,
Mr. Gary.
Wow. Hey, Mr. Gary.
I didn't know anything about you, Kev.
I'm still learning myself too. Thank you.
They got to you right. I came here because of him.
Other day.
Right. And then plus because I found out that your papers are at the school that my daughter graduated from, Cornell.
Mm.
I was like, wow, I gotta check this guy out.
Thank you.
As a few people in this room know, I can talk, so I'm not gonna talk too much. Okay, but
I heard an amen in the
you
yes.
Know, you hit on like several items as you've been talking, like the fireman.
Mm.
I was a firefighter here for almost 30 years.
Thank you for your service.
And today, but the reason I bring that up is because you said something about firemen, and
yes, sir.
Today, 8 years ago, was the uprising.
Yeah,
I fought fire for 25 hours straight. I was never so tired in my whole life.
Wow.
And the gift was I slept for 13 hours straight the day after, and I didn't even have to get up and go to the bathroom. You guys, I'll be 70 years old next month.
God bless you, son. Wow.
But on that,
No, I'm serious. I hope to be so lucky.
But also, like, to get back to Pac, I was one of those naysayers, unfortunately, in the beginning on hip hop, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. But then I read Michael Eric Dyson's book, Holla If You Hear Me.
Yes, sir. Mm.
And it freaked me out that he mentioned the corner of Brighton and Elmont in the book, and that was right around the corner from where I grew up.
Yes, sir.
And you know, all I know is, man, like, you're being who you really are. And then that guy to your right also being who he really
is. That's my brother for life.
Since I read all his books, now I'm going to have to read all of yours.
Well, I got 16 of them. You ready?
Definitely. And by the way, I already got this book, the store, to send one of those to my son. My
oldest
son is in Hazleton Federal Correctional Institute in freaking West Virginia, where the guards... if they want to call you the N-word, it ain't really much you can do.
Wow.
You know?
Wow.
And I'll leave it at that.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Receive your comments.
Thank you. Let me say this real quick. I forgot, because you put these books together, you forget what's in them, honestly, after reading it. I actually did the audiobook for this too, which was a lot of work, y'all. Yeah. But I actually have a piece in here. Why is Baltimore Burning? It was in HuffPost, April 2015. And since I'm involved, I forgot I wrote this in response to what you just talked about. Where did it go? I wrote this about what you were just describing when our brother was killed 8 years. Was it 8 years ago? Wow. Yeah. And you know what? It was I wasn't going to include it. Someone was working on the book, so you need to put this piece about Baltimore, because Baltimore is a metaphor for the whole country. It is, y'all.
Absolutely.
And it bothers me when people just go New York, D.C. and skip over Baltimore. Baltimore matters, y'all. In so many ways,
Hi, I'm Stephanie Lawrence. I'm a high school school librarian.
Thank you for who you are.
So I just want to give I'm from New Jersey, so I give
part?
A shout out. I'm from Hillside.
Hillside.
Yeah.
That's Essex County.
That's Union County.
Oh, it's Union County?
Yeah, right.
You're right.
Line.
That's right.
So
my bad.
A little shout out to Rutgers, because I almost went there until Morgan gave me money. So I'm going to do a shout out to Morgan too.
That's how we do. Go where the money's at.
Yes, definitely. I try to tell the students that too. So 7 years ago, I was a business teacher in the same high school that I'm at now. And I read your essay, Will Racism Ever End?
Yeah.
And so some of my kids, they say the N-word. So I started printing out the essay and making them read it.
Wow.
And it was
It's in here.
Is it?
Yeah.
I had one girl, after she read it, she was like, Miss Lawrence, I'm never gonna say that word again, just based on So fast forward to now, I feel like as a Black librarian, you know, even as a female Black librarian, we are unicorns. But I do feel like Maryland is making some strides. We have 4 members of the Maryland State Board of School Librarians that are African American, including myself. A couple of years ago, I was a finalist for Teacher of the Year. I was the first librarian to be able to do that.
Wow.
So we're making some strides. But and I've increased the library diversity collection by 40% since I took place in 5 years. But it is still, you know, a challenge getting our African American students to read. It is definitely become a safe space. So lunches are getting full and full. We have a lot of kids that have social anxieties. They don't really want to eat in the lunchroom, but they're coming to the library because it's a quiet space.
Yeah.
You know, I've tried to make it a tranquil space, you know, but just getting them to check out books is a hard, you know, struggle.
Yeah.
And it, you know, it's definitely inviting, and I definitely see the increase in the circulation, but it is still because they have so many things at home that they're dealing with that they don't feel like they have time to even read.
Yeah.
So I don't know if you have any suggestions on what we can do to increase that. I definitely know when you come back to Baltimore, definitely invite some of our youth, you know,
from
Baltimore County and Baltimore
City. Or I'll come to your school.
You can definitely come to my school.
Yeah, I will.
But, because they need to see people that look like them.
I agree.
I think that's what I had to do when I went to Morgan, when I had to see Black professors and I had to see, you know, read about Black people. Even though I went to a Black high school,
we see possibilities.
I didn't have Black, you know, teachers.
Right.
You know, nobody told me to go to Morgan. I just happened to apply.
Wow.
Never even visited the school. And it was the best choice that I could have ever made in my life.
Can you stay there first? I want to respond to everything you said as best I can. Thank you for, I just need to say, can we give librarians and teachers a round of applause? If you're able.
Frontline fighters.
Hold your hand up if you're a teacher. Hold your hand over your teacher. Any other teacher? Wow. I mean, we applaud for the speakers. We applaud for the athletes. Let's applaud for the librarians and teachers too, y'all. And principals. As long as I ain't got to go to the principal's office.
Oh, one more thing before you answer. Check out the 305s. In the library, because that's where a lot of our anti-racist novels are.
You said a 305.
305.
Thank you for
like
saying
Cass,
that.
Stamped.
Yeah.
Some of us, some of those books are in the 300s now.
Okay.
So you can get out of the 100s, get into the 300s.
Okay. Thank you. So for you and anyone else, my email is kevin@kevinpowell.net. It's mad easy, kevin@kevinpowell.net. My Facebook and Instagram are Kevin Powell in Brooklyn. Kevin Powell in Brooklyn. And I definitely, unfortunately, this trip, I'm only here tonight, and then we got to go to Philly tomorrow. But when I come back to Baltimore, let me say this. We're going to take that film on Black manhood, Black fatherhood all around the country. My wife and other educators, I've actually created a digital free study guide, a resource guide that's going to accompany that film. So we believe in what you're talking about. And it's going to include stuff to read, what to watch, what to listen to. And we're going to point to examples out there like Dr. Shields, my brother, brother Mills, and some of my other frat brothers out there. And all of us, we're going to make sure we include the Divine Nine, the faith-based community. Because we, to your, answer your question, I think that many of us, and I'm just going to step on some toes for a second, because I see this all around the country. For every sister or human being, however you identify yourself, like this person right here, who genuinely cares about young people, there's a lot of folks who do not by their actions or lack of actions. And, you know, I'll give you an example. I used to go to a church in Brooklyn, and one of the reasons I stopped going to that church is because they had a Black male ministry, but the Black males were not involved in the community of Brooklyn. They would go away to read the Bible together in the woods, and then they would ask people like me who were involved in the community, is it really that bad out there? Our young people need, one reason why a lot of Black males aspire to be a rapper, an athlete, or some form of hustle on the streets is because that's what they see on a regular basis. And one reason why I do show up in places as a writer, you know how many young people have said to me, I've never met a writer who was alive, or I've never met a Black writer. I'm one of those people who never had a Black male teacher, K through 12, y'all. You know what I'm talking about. You know, what's the solution? It's not some grand solution. Show up. And I also think it's important, like a lot of times when I go to these schools, it could be grade school, high school, or college. What do? A lot of speakers come in there, Brother Dave, and I'm talking about, and they just talk at young people. When I was in high school, if you ask me right now, can you name the speakers, 9th grade, 10th grade, 11th grade, I don't know who they were. Because they sounded like Charlie Brown's teacher. Wah, 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 wah. What I do when I work with young people, no matter what the setting is, pass the mic. You start with them talking. And you as an adult fill in when necessary. Don't be so full of yourself and your 16 books, Kevin Powell, and your credentials, and understand that your responsibility is to listen and let them know. What I say to young people is a safe space, no judgment. I don't get on them about their cursing. I don't get on them about whether they're speaking so-called proper. I mean, what the hell is proper English anyway, y'all, in this country? Seriously. You know what I mean? But also, I've seen older people condemn their hairstyles, their piercings, their tattoos, their clothes, their pants are sagging. I'm like, you're focused on all this stuff, but you never listen to the young people. And so I think the first thing is to show young people that we actually love them and we care enough to listen to them. Because what we're doing, what I'm seeing, and this is not just Black young people, I've seen it with white youth, Black youth, Latinx youth, Indigenous youth, Asian youth, across the board, all gender identities. Y'all remember the book, Lord of the Flies? That's what we're doing to young people. And that's why many of them are like, these adults are whack. I'm just going to plug in. I'm going to be over here. Because adults are bugging out. Because many of us forgot what it's like to be young. And so I think we start there and then I ask honest questions. What do y'all like to read? Well, you know what I do first when I work with young people? I say that every single one of you is a genius. Every one of you is a genius. Every single one of you is a genius. And then I'm like, You know, and I don't even condemn, if they use the N-word, I'm not going to condemn them. You know, I'm just like, yo, okay, that's cool, but can you be a genius and an N-word at the same time? Does that really work? You know what I'm saying? I flip it on them. And so I think you just meet heads where they are. You know what I'm saying? Yeah. One reason why I think what me and Brother Dave are into, things like sports, hip-hop, pop culture.
I have a sports section.
You know what I'm saying? Mm-hmm. How, even if you don't like what young people are listening to, I mean, don't lie, y'all who are stuck in the 90s, y'all know who I'm talking about out there. All the music was so much dope, but y'all can't tell me that your parents didn't trash the music in the 90s as well. Yeah, they did. They said it was garbage and trash. Every generation says that. I watched Questlove's documentary film, Summer of Soul. That documentary is 1969, and the young people in there are saying their parents are saying that soul music was whack in 1969. You feel what I'm saying? And so what I'm also telling y'all, what do I do? Stop the generational dissing. Stop the generational dissing. Mm. There's things that young people can learn from us, but there's also things we can learn from them. Mm. But if you think it's only a one-way street, you become part of the problem. And then what I say to young people is like, okay, it's cool. If you don't like to read, I flip it. What are you into? What are you passionate about? Okay, you like cars, you like hair, you like nails, whatever it is, let's read something about that. You like fashion, let's read, just to get them into the habit of reading.
We have all those programs at our school.
You know what I'm talking about. Mm. But the key thing is it has to be a group of folks who are saying, mm-hmm. hey, you know, and I think at the end of the day, like what I deal with too, like a lot of kids, I say, what do you want to be? Well, I just want to do hair. I want to be a barber. Then let's flip it. Why don't you own the hair salon? Why don't you own the barbershop? I just want to work on cars. Well, why can't you be the owner of the car shop?
We're trying to get the Cosmo kids to take a business class.
Exactly. You know,
but they don't have the space in their schedules a lot of the time. So.
Mm. Well, you know, because the mythology of this thing is that everybody's just busy. How many of y'all have said, I'm just busy. I'm so busy. I mean, man, come on now. I mean.
I'm busy on my phone.
My wife says to me all the time, are you listening? I'm like, I realize, Kev, you got to get off your phone and actually listen to what your wife is saying. We can't be so. Let's bring it back to our frat brother, Dr. King. In 1967, Vietnam War speech. Yep, he condemned the Vietnam War. But one of the things that stuck out to me in that speech, because you got to really read. People don't know Dr. King. We don't know that. We don't read Dr. King. We say we love him every January, but then we don't read him. But in that speech, he said that America, 1967, we're moving from a thing-oriented society, from people-oriented society to a thing-oriented society. He said it in 67, he was saying we were becoming obsessed with things. Americans are obsessed with things. My wife and I go on vacation in the West End, and we notice that Americans are on the beach, on their cell phones, screaming into the phones on the beach, because we don't know how to unplug from stuff. And so when you talk about young people, we can't condemn young people. How many, I'm not trying to call you out, but if you're born in the 40s, 50s, 60s, 70s, 80s, hold your hand up. Just hold your hand up. If you're born in the 90s or 2000, hold your hand up. A few folks. Now, not to judge, but am I right? If you're born in the 90s or beyond, you literally were born into a world where this existed. Yeah. Am I right? And so what I'm saying is, if we're in leadership positions like you, any of us in this room, and a lot of us do work with young people, we got to take into account it's a different thing happening. And so that means you might want to adjust how you reach out to young people. It's kind of like when I was teaching English back in the day, I'm like, I can't teach English the way I was taught English. Well, here's the subject. Here's the predicate. You know, nah, man. Anybody trying to hear that?
Yeah, because now it's things going through my mind, because the book that you're talking about, we could do like a book study and it could be, you know, a forum and different.
We have to adjust to the times. Mm. You know what I mean? Or what Frantz Fanon said in Wretched the Earth, meet the people where they are, then you bring them forward. Mm. But if you distant where they are, you can't bring them forward.
And I know you're going to Philly, but if you come back to Baltimore before June.
You said June.
Yeah, before June.
Before June. We're going on honeymoon next couple weeks.
Well, check out the BMA exhibit. It's a hip hop exhibit at the BMA right now.
And here, I will.
Excellent.
Yes. Is it Baltimore hip hop history?
Yes.
I promise I will.
It's supposed to be great. Kevin Wheeler.
Hey, Mr. Wheeler.
Hey, Dave.
Hey, Mr. Wheeler.
What's up, Kev?
Good to see you.
So I'm one of those people. I was 15, and I'll never forget when you said to Julie, you know, black people can't be racist. Mm. And what was crazy to me about that was, like, I thought that I understood racism. My dad, when there was this program, I'll just digress for a little bit. Mm-hmm. There was this program that was about Dr. King's. It was the first time his birthday was going to be celebrated as a national holiday. Mm-hmm. And there was a lot of controversy around it. And they said, if a black man and a white man, or a black person and a white person, went for the same job, had the exact same credentials, who do you think would get the job? Yeah. And I was like, it would be equal, because, you know, Dr. King fought and won, and that's what he died for. And my dad was like, No. You have to be twice like as better. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
And 10 times as smart just to get the exact same thing they have. And you may lose it just for one mistake. And I remember when you said to Julie that racism, black people can't be racism. We don't have the political power. We don't have the economic power. We don't have the social power. You know, there's no way in the world that I can do to you what you can do to me. Like, it blew my mind. I was like, no, I've never heard anybody say that on MTV, where David Bowie was like, man, y'all don't like black people on here.
And you shout out to David Bowie for saying that, seriously. Yeah.
So, like, even though I didn't do anything with that knowledge, I just kind of...
But you have.
Well, now, yeah, now I do a lot of work in the community. I do a little something in the community, and I'm a union organizer for AFT.
That's important.
And Brother Dave has been on me for a long time to like start using my voice. And a really incredible person passed away recently. His name is Eddie Conway, and he's in prison for 44 years. But in that time, he never felt sorry for himself. He never was better. He organized the entire time he was there. He organized a union for prisoners. He organized mentoring organizations for prisoners. And he really changed people's lives inside. And as soon as he got out, he could have just chilled. He could have just put his feet up. But he went to work on people like me, like Brother Kev and Gary, for all these, like so many people around the world.
Yes, sir.
And with his passing, there was a lot of anger I had. Just like how I would say people, you know, Eddie Conway passed away. Oh, who's Eddie Conway? Who is that? It's or just the anger about like, you could take somebody's life away and they fight very hard to remember that they're human and they succeed.
Yeah.
But in the end, what people are going to remember is that he passed away more than what he lived for. And I do want to do something about that.
You should.
But the fear of like, it's not going to be like, how do you, as someone who wants to tell a story, who feel like you need to tell a story, but are afraid that story is not going to be nearly good enough for a life or a struggle that so many people go through? How do you just get past that?
It's a great question, Mr. Wheeler. I think we have to make a conscious decision. Can y'all repeat after me? Fear is a prison.
Prison.
Because it is. Now, there's nothing wrong with being afraid of doing certain things, but I think we have to push past that fear. There's many things I've been scared of. Just as an activist, I mean, come on. And as a writer. But I think that we can't be the ceiling blocking ourselves, you know, from going upwards. I think that, you know, part of the job of us as leaders, and what is a leader? A simple definition, they, no matter how they identify themselves, whatever their pronouns happen to be, change the direction of the conversation. They create a new vocabulary. That's what a leader does. A leader either creates or supports an institution, like this library, an organization, a business that supports the community. That's a leader. You know what I mean? A leader doesn't just do what everyone else is doing, but you say, let's go in a new direction. And I just want to say this to you and all the men out here, because we have a good number of black men here. And this is really touching my heart, because I'm going to be honest with y'all. For years, if I depended on black men to buy my books, I probably wouldn't sell a lot of books. And I'd be part of it. My alpha brothers have been supportive. There's some brothers who are activists in the community. But unfortunately, I think, again, we understand the devastating effects of heroin in the 70s, crack cocaine in the 80s, the AIDS epidemic, you know, the prison industrial complex, you know, Reagan putting folks in jail, Clinton with that crime bill in the 90s. Y'all who love Clinton, not forget what Clinton did to black people. You know, it's been devastating on black males. And so one of the things that's happened to me, I literally was in college where black men were active all over the place. So now when I go to colleges, the master class I just taught at Prairie View AM University, my wife would tell you, we had one consistent black male in that class. You know what I mean? And so the most important thing we can do, brothers, is to show up. Show up. My father didn't show up. I saw my father 2 or 3 times in my life. I know there are good fathers in this room who are black men. I know there are good fathers in this room. But we got to multiply ourselves. So what does a leader do too? You multiply yourself. You encourage other folks. You know, one of the best things about our film is not just about Black manhood, it's about Black fatherhood. You have brothers who didn't have fathers, but we're like, we're not going to spread that narrative that Black fathers don't exist. Black fathers do exist, but we got to amplify that. And some Black folks, Black men don't know how to be fathers, but if you hear Brother Mills talking about it, you hear Brother Dr. Lamar talking about it, then you're like, oh, I can be a good Black father because there's examples right here in front of me. Does that make sense, y'all? And so I think that when we allow ourselves to be captured by fear, then we are going against our ancestors, Frederick Douglass, Maryland, Harriet Tubman, Maryland. Y'all know what I'm talking about. You know what I'm saying? If they could do what they did, you know, Reginald Lewis, I see his nephew out there, one of my dear brothers. Man, the first time I saw that book title, Why Should White Guys Have All the Fun? It blew my mind because he was a dignified, proud, suited Black man who was our first billionaire. I didn't know that was possible. And the fact that he had the audacity to say that as a book title was giving folks for generations hope that anything is possible. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
You have not heard anyone here tonight say we hate anyone. Black folks don't really get down like that. Not really. Now, Black folks can be prejudiced because my mama would be like,
it's okay.
But she was born in 1943 in South Carolina and had to deal with racism and sexism and classism. So if she wanted to say a few words here and there, she got that right. Given what she survived, she's about to be 80. But I think that, you know, we have to show up and we got to be consistent with that showing up. I'm tired, man. You know, part of the reason I'm tired because it's like, you know, there's a few of us who consistently do the work and then everybody else is waiting for us to do the work. Y'all, some of you know what I'm talking about. And then if someone dies, like Brother Conway, rest in peace, you know, or Mr. Belafonte, like, oh my God, all that they did. I'm like, well, what are you doing? Yeah. Well, I'm raising my kids. Well, guess what? Some of those kids like me didn't have fathers, so they actually need to see you as well. Mm. You know what I mean? And so even if you can't be their biological father, at least they see that Black fathers are possible. Black librarians are possible. Black teachers are possible. Does that make sense, y'all?
Yeah.
You know, any community just needs to see possibilities, right? And so I think that's what it is, man. Like, how many people know what a Black union organizer is? Even though that's a potential career. Does that make sense, y'all? You know what I mean? Not everybody gets to be Lamar Jackson, but guess what? Maybe some of you could be a sports agent or be a sports writer. You could be something. But if we don't show people and amplify it, then we become part of the problem. The thing that kills me, y'all, the Garvey movement, not the civil rights movement, was the biggest mass movement of Black people in this country 100 years ago, 1920s. They didn't have this. They didn't have any of this stuff. They used mimeograph machines. But Malcolm X, for example, his parents were Garveyites. His mama from the West Indies of Grenada, his daddy from Georgia, they were Garveyites. Garvey movie was so big, we got Black folks in 2023 in Brooklyn talking about they are Garveyites. Yeah. Yeah. Wow. Because they showed you what's possible. A dark-skinned Black man saying, you are beautiful, Black people. You are beautiful, Black people. You are beautiful. Yeah. You know what I mean? And so we have to say this stuff, and it can't just be one or two people, because when Harry Belafonte dies, or Dr. King gets killed, or Malcolm gets killed, or this one goes, that one goes, we like, damn, what are we going to do? Well, the leadership you're waiting for is in the mirror.
Yeah.
And we got to get out of the savior notion of, oh my God, Barack, or the Clintons, or someone's going to save us. No, we need everyone to step up their game to the next level. Mm. You know what I mean? How many of y'all have ever had, I'm going to stop here, Brother Cleve. Any more questions over here? How many of y'all have ever had someone come to your house who said they were a handy person and they had a toolbox? Right? Now imagine if they opened a toolbox and all they got in the toolbox is a screwdriver.
Mm.
What they gonna fix?
A screw.
A screw. It might not be the right kind of screwdriver.
Yeah, get the Phillips head. Yeah.
My point is, Brother Wheeler and everyone out here, and I'll leave y'all with this because I keep thinking about this fascist in Florida. I just spent a year at Prairie View with the fascism with that governor of Texas. And the insanity of the governor of Texas, he's disabled. So he belongs to a community that's marginalized, and he's still hateful. And so what I'm getting at, if we're going to let fear hold us back and apprehension and low self-esteem, I've had low self-esteem. You heard me say up here tonight, I've been a drunk. You know what I mean? I've been violent. I've been the victim of violence. I've had all this stuff happen in my life. But the grace of God and my ancestors, here I am. I'm like, man, I feel, as my wife has said, there's a renaissance happening. And I'm like, I got a responsibility, but we can't do it by ourselves. You know what I mean? We need people to step up, because if we don't step up, they that we talk about are going to continue to win. And guess what? As we look at that child right there and other young people in this room, be it Sophia, other people, what world do they have to look forward to in the next 20, 30, 40 years when books are being banned? People are literally being put on buses from Florida and Texas and shipped around the country. Y'all know what I'm talking about. We see the articles saying that women may have to go back to backroom abortions. And go give me that. I'm a Christian, y'all, but don't give me that hypocrisy. Well, this is what, you know, y'all coming out here with this anti-abortion stuff. You hate queer people. Then you claim you love Jesus.
Yeah. Yeah.
You claim that Jesus is about love.
Yeah.
Who appointed you God? So what do we need to do? We need people who are fearless, Brother Wheeler, who are going to tell the truth and organize and be shining examples of what we need so other people can be inspired. You know, Brother Russell knows what I'm talking about. I didn't have a father, but between the autobiography of Malcolm X and your uncle and other Black men that I saw, I was like, man, I could do this. That's why I got 16 books. Thank you.
Beautiful, Kevin.
Thank you.
I want to take this opportunity to thank Dave and Kevin for this conversation. This is what this room was built for. This right here.
Thank you, Brother
Cleve. Very quickly, if you don't know Dave's writing, Dave's been writing about the intersection of sports and politics for over 20 years. I met Dave over 20 years of politics and prose for his first book, and I've been reading him ever since. Please check him out, Dave Zirin. And Kevin, just thank you so much. This was this felt like a love letter to Baltimore. This felt very much about what this place is and what we do. And I would be remiss to not say right now, this is the 20th anniversary coming up in November, the 20th anniversary of our African American apartment, wow, co-founded by my colleague Vivian Fisher back there.
That's Vivian Fisher.
So please make sure to come back to more of our programs. Kevin's going to come out, be out there to sign books for you in a second. I got you out there. It just gets, yeah, I'll bring you out there. Don't worry. Very quickly, Tia from Urban Reads Books.
Yes. Hello, how you doing? Thank you, Kevin, for that. What I caught in the end, I said, dang. This is beautiful. Thank you. Everybody, I'm Tia, the owner of Urban Reads Bookstore.
Woo!
I am. Thank you. I am sold out of books. They sold out. So you can still order the book and I will send it to you on me. You can still order the book with me right now and I'm going to order more books. And then I will ship it out to you, and then that shipping would be on me. Mm-hmm. My location is 3008 Greenmount Avenue, Greenmount and 30th.
It'll be better for you, Kev.
Yeah.